Welcome, everybody. Welcome to tonight's Archaeology Cafe. Boy, what a great evening. Our speaker, Art Vokes, is going to speak for about half an hour, 40 minutes, and then we're going to open the floor to questions. Really, the best thing about these Archaeology Cafes is the type of questions that we get from you all. They're always very smart, and we always have a really amazing conversation about the topic, so I'm very much looking forward to that. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Art Vokes from the Collections Department at the Arizona State Museum. Art?
Does everybody have a handout? Okay. So I thought what we would do first is, if you look at the handouts, the front, well, the non-title page, the front page, is going to be is a brief chronology. When you're talking about trade and exotic material, you're not staying in one area of the Southwest. You're going to be dealing with the entire Southwest. And so I've tried to put kind of highlights of the chronology crossing all the regions that we'll be talking about. So there's Hohokam, Northwest Mexico, Chihuahua in that area, the Anasazi, and then Mimbres and Highland Mogollon. And you can sort of cross, because I'll be talking about all these different areas and during periods and with different materials. So the next part of this will be sort of an introduction into the various trade networks that we know about or we think we know about that were tied into this exchange system. And I've got one map here, but there's a version in your packets of this. And these are based on historic documents and on the archaeology, and in some cases, they're based on conjecture. There's four trade networks that are postulated coming out of California, and those are actually fairly well known. On the basis of both historic documents going back in terms of the Anglo documents, then into the Spanish, and the Spanish trade networks coming across, and they were talking about the native trade networks, and those systems then go back into the antiquity. Today we know most of those systems by virtue of the interstate highway system follows those trade networks. The Bow system, which runs through, it's the second from the bottom coming over from California, is I-10. I-40 is up to the north, and I-8 is to the south. The fact that these things are run the way they do is because of that history of trade systems and the establishment of the trail networks. To the south, there are five systems that are postulated coming out of the Gulf, from the Gulf of California and from central Mexico. And those are, some of those are better known than others. The one coming across from the northern end of the Gulf of California, coming across the western parts of Arizona, the central west Papagria is probably the best known of the systems and best documented. And that's this one that comes up across here. It's a broad arrow on your map. And that is basically incorporates all of those, that central part of what we call the Papagria, or the area around the Barry Goldwater Range and the western part of the Don Otham Reservation. That system incorporates all of those north-south valleys that are out in there. And we know from the archaeological record that there is an extensive campsites in that area, and there are some fairly substantial temporary sort of seasonal village sites out there, and they are covered with shell. So that's one of the major trade networks coming in with related to shell. The one that runs up the Colorado River is not as well known. It's a logical system. but a whole lot of work hasn't been done on the Colorado River, and most of the sites that would be there are either washed away by the river or under deep silts, so you don't have a lot of evidence directly for it. We do have indirect evidence for it that we can get into when we're looking at some of the materials that are showing up at sites that are peripheral to this system. Then you have various sites that are trade networks that are coming off of the river systems that are running into Mexico itself, the Rio Concepcion, the Bevis Bay, the Rio Yaqui, these systems. We have some evidence archaeological for those, and we also, it's some of it in terms of the detail is somewhat hypothetical. So we know from Spanish records and also that there were these trade networks were in existence at the time of contact, and in fact, some of these were followed by the entradas coming up into the southwest. There's a series of trade networks that tie into the coming from the east. These ultimately tie into the Mississippi Valley area and to the Gulf of Mexico. Those networks are largely conjectural. We don't know enough about the archaeology in some of that area to really know what was going on there. We do know that late, very late, you had the trade networks that linked the plains groups with Taos and Pecos and those sites. And those are the northernmost of them, the ones which run across from coming out of northern Texas and Oklahoma area. And we know those have some antiquity. We have sites in Oklahoma that have shell from the Gulf of California. So that's the connection there. There's one burial at Spiral Mound that had 1,200 pieces of shell out of the Gulf of California. So that connection we know. There's mainly the ones coming up the Rio Grande and the Rio, the riverine systems across central Texas that is more questionable whether they really were in existence. So these are the systems that are coming in from the outside. The internal systems that branch off of that are not, or no, we don't really show on the maps, but they're going to be running out along the drainages and across the region, but they're sort of like capillaries running off of these major avenues of trade coming into the region. Now, so what's coming up? What are we talking about when we talk about exotics? There are different levels of exotics. By definition, an exotic is something that is not locally available and is probably not a utilitarian type of material. So for the research that I was involved in and have been for many years, I've focused on shell as one of these materials. We've also looked into the distribution of things like turquoise, copper bells, and then a non-jewelry, but the feathers and macaws, which are probably the most distant of the exotics coming in, and we'll get into those in a minute. To talk about shell, we have to say that there's two broad categories of shell that are used by Native Americans in the prehistory of this region. One was marine, and you've got the marine shell would have been coming in from the West Coast, from the Gulf of California or the Sea of Cortez, and then a little bit very late comes in from the Gulf of Mexico, but it's only into the eastern part of the Southwest. Most of the shell coming in is coming from the Gulf of California. That starts around in the early agricultural period, which was around 1200 BCE, before the Christian era. And it brought in a lot of small shells and shells that were being made into ornaments like pendants and beads. In the early part of the things that trade network first starts when we first start getting substantial villages developing in the basin here. And you get material coming in from about 20% of the shell coming in is coming from the California coast, and about 80% comes from the Gulf of California. As I said, it's mostly beads and pendants. They had a thing for glossy shells, for nacreous shells, to the point where they would actually coat some of the beads in mica to make them look like they were nacreous. That trade network gets established, as I said, back in the early agricultural period. There are no bracelets at that time, which is an interesting contrast, because the following period, the early ceramic period, which starts at around AD 0 or so and goes into about 500 BC or B, or A, let's see, what is it? I'm trying to be politically correct here, BCE, as opposed to AD. CE, Christian era.
Current
era, whatever. But the early ceramic period, you see bracelets become in, and it's a very dramatic change. Whereas there were no bracelets in the early agricultural period, 80% of the assemblages of the early ceramic period are bracelets. And so the question is, what has happened? What transformed this? And it's not fully understood. My own feeling is that as ceramics were being introduced from the south, there was a package that came in, and that you had bracelets being made in Michoacan and those areas along the west coast of Mexico at that time. And I think they brought in that technology and that interest. And whether it was, as Howie wanted it to be, he postulated there was an influx of people. But you don't really see these people in the archaeological record in other ways. So I think it was more of a package of ideas that came in. So that's when you start getting bracelets. And bracelets will stay in the Hohokam region throughout the rest of the pre-contact era. However, other things start to come in at the same over time. Now, your other exotics, including things like copper bells and things along that line, come in much later. And you can see when you look at things, I've put in photos of various types of ornaments and things into your handouts, but there are also some maps that deal with the distributions of stuff. And we'll come back to those maps in a minute, but copper bells come into the Southwest. The knowledge of how to work metal comes into West Mexico around AD 800. It's brought in from the south. It comes from northern South America, and off of Colombia and that region, Peru, and those areas. There it's known going back to about 6,000 BCE. But you have that knowledge gets brought up the west coast of Mexico, and it comes in along with an exchange system where they were coming up the coast to get spondylus shells, which were highly prized by South American groups for money and for other types of stuff. And they brought in the knowledge of working metals first into Oaxaca and that region and then up the coast. And as I said, it gets into West Mexico, the area around Nayarit, Jalisco, those areas around AD 800. And then it gets brought into the first copper bells that come in or show up in the Southwest, come in around 1,000 or so, between 950 and 1,000. There are 28 that were found in a warehouse that was what they think was a warehouse at Snaketown. And those may be the earliest copper bells that we know of. So around 1,000, you start to get the copper bells. Right about that same time is when the macaws. Now there are two types of macaws and a couple of types of parrots that are involved in this trade networks. You have the thick-billed parrot, which is a green parrot that is indigenous to Sonora, a little bit of southern Arizona, and the very southwest portion of New Mexico. It's now pretty much extinct in most of the northern range, but is still known for in Mexico. You have a military macaw, which is a green macaw, that occurs in Sinaloa and in the sort of scrub forests of southern Sonora. And then you have the scar. That are in this region or in sort of northern, there it goes, in northern Mexico where they have any evidence for raising macaws. So we really don't know where the connection is. The closest native population would have been the Huasteca area, which is about 1,100 miles. So it's a major trek to go get those guys. But they start showing up around 1000 AD and are part of this exchange network that comes in. And there may be some interesting aspects to that exchange that we'll get to in a minute. But so we have two things which are coming in right about the same time, copper bells and macaws. Shell's been here for a long time. The first types of stuff coming in terms of this is, if you look on some of the charts, there's some maps here, and you'll see that there are, in the early part where you have macaws coming in, they are fairly extensively found in the sort of over in the Members area. And they also are found a lot up into the Pueblo area around Chaco and west into northern Arizona, particularly to Wapatki, where there was 32 macaws that were found in the deposits there. Many of these have been typed as scarlet macaws, but it's kind of, the IDs on macaws are, it's tricky if you don't have the skull. Although military macaws tend to be smaller, so you can say that the really large ones are probably scarlet, but the smaller ones may not be. The thing that's interesting about these birds is that they look like they come in as fledglings, and they're raised until they're about a year old, and then it looks like they were ritually sacrificed when they were about a year old, which is right around the spring equinox, which is when they would have been reaching their first time that they had the full fledgling, the full feathers routine with all the red and elaborate coloration. There's a photo that I put in which shows a scarlet macaw in flight, and you can get an idea of how these were, how colorful these birds were and why the feathers would have been sought so much. They are very difficult to raise. Adult scarlet macaws that are captured from in the wild cannot be domesticated. You could keep them in a cage, but you cannot handle them. They're very aggressive. So if you want to be able to handle them and to work with them, you have to get them as very young, newly born, kind of fledgling kinds of birds, and you start to train them. One of the interesting things, which is in an article, recent article by Pat Gilman, looking at the macaw trade and some of the iconography, is that when you get a very young macaw and you start to raise it, it will bond with the person who is feeding it and who's raising it. And it is a one-to-one type of bond oftentimes. They do not transfer well. And as a result, what Pat Gilman has suggested is that people were actually going south, or in this case to Huasteca, which would have been southeast, making the trek to get these birds and then bringing them back, and that an individual who went to get the bird would have been bonded with that bird, and they would have gotten a certain amount of status by having that bird in their possession. This may explain why they are sort of they're so rare, but also why they occur in only certain sites. They also are very susceptible to the being chilled. They will, as young birds, they will die very easily if they get cold. Most of the macaws, the full-bodied macaws, where you have a burial with a macaw body, occur in the Mimbres area and, as I said, up into the Chaco region and over towards Wapaki. The occurrences of macaws in the Hohokam region is more often as parts, wing elements and things. So they may very well have been trading for the feathers and the parts of the bird rather than getting the whole bird in down into the desert regions, where they would have been really susceptible also to the very dry arid climates down here. The one exception that I know of is down in outside of Nogales. There was a site now known as El Macayo, where there was a military macaw that was found, a burial of a military macaw. And there was a very young macaw that was found, that was in that deposit. You have these types of materials coming in. As I said, they start around 1,000. They're coming in. They seem to be tied into this Mimbres Chaco Wapaki nexus, this curve that comes up along the western part of New Mexico and then around through the plateau. The materials in the stuff that's in the Hohokam region tends to be, as I said, for the macaws, it's elements, and with the copper bells, you get types of bells there that don't occur in the Mimbres area and up into Wapaki. So it looks like they may be on a separate exchange system. Around 1200 AD, things seem to fall apart and you get a hiatus in the trade. Macaws aren't being imported, copper bells seem to drop off. And there, what looks to be is that there's about a 50-year to a 75-year hiatus, and then it starts up again. Well, what its timing it seems to be related to is the rise of the Casas Grandes Pacame system, and that is a different structure. You have growing pens or macaw pens at Pacame. There's about 300 or so different pens that have been found both at Pacame and in surrounding villages and sites where they were actually raising macaws, and they were raising the scarlet macaw. So there you have a source for this material that is then being traded north, and those seem to be going up into towards Zuni and up into and out towards the Hohokam region to some extent. The other thing that happens at that time is your metallurgy changes. The copper bells that were made previously were pure sort of native copper using a lost wax method. They learned to be able to make mixing with tin and some other like some materials, a much stronger metal and more flexible metal. Can't think of the term right now, but alloy. It's an alloy. And that allowed them to make much more elaborate types of copper bells. And I've got a couple of pictures of some of the more elaborate ones. The most elaborate is the little turtle copper bell that I've seen that was pictured from Pacame. And there's a similar one from a site in western or eastern Arizona. I'm trying to remember which one it is, but I can't off the top of my head. But it's very, very elaborate types of bells. More often, the elaboration is more like this wire wrapping that you get on that one that's in the kind of the bottom right-hand corner of the page. That comes in, as I said, after about 1250, and you get those coming in across the southwest and throughout up into the Salado region in eastern Arizona. Gila Pueblo had some up into the Tonto Basin, this sort of whole connection, and it looks like it's connected down towards into the Pacame, the Casas Grandes exchange system that's down there. So the question then is, one of the questions is, what are we trading south? What people have generally thought was moving south was turquoise. In Mexico, in central Mexico, The earliest occurrence of turquoise occurs in the area around Guerrero around 600 BC in some shaft tombs. And it's kind of a scattering of it in that region going into about around 400 AD, and I'm going to use AD rather than BCE and stuff because it just rolls better. But it's around 400 AD, you start to get, there's a development of a complex around Alta Vista in the modern state of Zacatecas, where they're doing extensive mining of turquoise-like deposits. And I have to say it's turquoise-like because apparently it's not mineralogically turquoise, but it's a very similar blue stone. And you have these incredible mine shafts that were being dug into the gravels and stuff, including ones which there were audits that went in, and then you'd have a room and then line shafts running off of that, off of the room. But they were following the veins of these stones. And this mining operation was feeding the demand for turquoise that was coming out of central Mexico, down in the Teotihuacan region, and then later it was feeding the stuff that was started to feed into Cholula and those regions. Those mines sort of drop out at around 900 AD. We're not sure why. There's still deposits there, but the system, that particular system, seems to no longer be used. What happens is that you start seeing extensive rise of turquoise in the Southwest. The earliest turquoise, extensive mining of turquoise that I've been able to find, it occurs actually in the Tucson Basin region. There is a site north in the northwest part of the basin here called Red Tail, and some of you are probably familiar with it. There was extensive excavations by the Arizona Archaeological Historical Society there in the 1980s, and then Desert Archaeology did some more work there in connection with that, and then more recently there's a site called Coachline, which is really basically Red Tail Village. It's just got Coachline Road running between the two parts, but it's the same site. And that site had about over 3,100 pieces of turquoise in it. It's the only site in the basin that has that many, that has that amount of material. It dates from about 850 to about 950. It's a primary colonial period site. And for many, many years, we didn't know where that turquoise came from. The people tried to source it, and they couldn't figure it out. It didn't go to any of the known sources. About 10 years ago, I think it is, there was some excavations that were done in the Silverbell Mountains along Trigo Wash. And they found an archaeological site that was contemporaneous with Red Tail, and it sits on top of a turquoise deposit. And that deposit, funny thing, we took examples, specimens from that deposit and from Red Tail, and they do match. So that's the source for the turquoise coming from to Red Tail. They apparently were shipping it down to the Red Tail Village, and where they were processing it and then making it into beads and pendants primarily. What's interesting is that you don't see the turquoise spreading out over the basin. It's not in the other sites in the basin. So where is it going? Well, as it turns out, the other site that has a lot of turquoise in the Southwest at that time was Snaketown. And it's found in a lot of the deposits at Snaketown. I think I'm going to, I could go cheat and look it up, but I think it's roughly half of the deposits that dated to that period, the mortuary deposits at Snaketown had turquoise in it at the time, at the contemporary time, according to Howery's from the 1964 excavations. I don't know how it fits back to the 1935 excavations, but I suspect that the turquoise that was being worked at Red Tail was moving north into that market. We also know that that the Snake Town hotlands was tying into trade coming in from the California system, primarily this one that runs across kind of along the I-40 system. It runs, there's a turquoise mine up there, Howland Springs, I think it's called. Then there's a map that shows all the turquoise known mine sites in there. And that was the source for a lot of the turquoise at Snake Town, they think. And certainly they've been able to source that with some of the Snake Town turquoise. You also have, there's a chance that some of this was going south and going into the Mesoamerican market. However, there's not really anything at Red Tail that you can look at that says Mesoamerica to you. I mean, there's no ceramics, there's no imported material coming in. What is interesting is that at Coachline, there were two burials that were found that were very rich that had shell trumpets. And they, when I was trying to blow on this thing earlier and not be most successful, but we have in those things, we have two very burned, but they are clearly trumpets. We have the mouthpieces of these things. These are the earliest shell trumpets in the Southwest that we know of. We also have one of those burials appeared to be a person working stone and was a stone carver. And this was a burial that was excavated by a desert a couple of years ago. And there was some very elaborate pallets that could be lost in the assemblage from Snake Town. These were incredibly ornate carved pallets with animal forms and stuff on it. So that kind of reaffirms this connection up towards Snake Town. Certainly this person was carving stone itself too. So this person may have been carving the stone and sending it up, we don't know, you know. But there's two pallets at Snake Town that have the same animal figure on the corners of the pallet, but different counts. And so they actually make kind of a set between the two burial sets, or the two sites. Redtail is abandoned around 850 or so, stops and things, and there's no site that picks up on the turquoise in the basin here. Snake Town continues to have turquoise, but right around 900, what you have is the rise of Chaco. And Chaco is interesting in many ways, as you probably are aware, but it's one of the things that marks Chaco is its complete dominance of the turquoise trade networks up in the northern part of the Southwest. They're tied into everything. We have evidence from Chaco of turquoise coming into those sites from as far north as the northern part of Nevada. The number 9 turquoise source up in northern Nevada, they've been able to match to some of the turquoise at Chaco. So you have this incredible network that's pulling turquoise into Chaco. There's estimated that Chaco may have had, the Pueblo Bonito alone had over 500,000 pieces of turquoise in it. A lot of the big houses and the sites around Chaco are extensively tied into manufacturing of turquoise, mostly beads and small pendants. Interestingly enough, they are not involved in manufacturing mosaics. That is exclusively found at the great houses in Chaco Canyon, Pueblo Bonito primarily, but also Chetrakettel. So it seems that seems to have been restricted to a very set of people that were doing the mosaics. There are some very elaborate burials at Chaco where they're just covered with turquoise in the early part of the site. So it seems to have been controlling a lot of the turquoise trade at that point. The collapse of Chaco at around 1200, the Chacoan system, seems to tie into this hiatus I was talking about with the import of copper bells and macaws. And you then get turquoise that, a lot more sites start getting turquoise in the Southwest, and you start to see it being spread out But the demand is definitely continuing, and it's getting, it becomes much more dispersed. You see it in places like grasshopper. Grasshopper has a lot of turquoise in certain parts of it. But grasshopper had an advantage because it was sitting near a turquoise source up in, I can't think of the name of the canyon.
Canyon Creek.
Canyon Creek has a turquoise source there, and we've been able to match the turquoise from Canyon Creek up into grasshopper. And grasshopper was also probably then spreading it out through the, up onto the plateau. So there's a change in the way the nature of how that exchange is going on. In Mesoamerica, you see the rise of Tula and the Toltec systems, and they have a very high demand for turquoise. In Mesoamerica, turquoise is associated with fertility, with rain, water, and it's actually the symbol for life itself. So this huge demand that was for this stone was going on as well. There's some thought that Pacame may have been tied into that, feeding that demand south. And they were then getting the macaws north, coming north, and they were raising macaws and then spreading it out in return. Later on, after Pacame drops out, you see turquoise, the demand continuing, but it seems to be more of a dispersed network going to the south. And there is some evidence to suggest that some of the statelets that developed in Sonora may have been tied into the trade network that was going in to get those stones. We know that into the historic era, macaws were still being traded up into this area. Kino talks about macaws at Sanavir. He doesn't tell you what type, so we're not clear in that, but there was subsequent to later Padres, or however you want to say, Father Velarde, who was later, a little bit later than Kino, talks about macaws, and he actually mentions that they had red feathers. So they were scarlet macaws, presumably. And they were being raised out at Sanavir. He also talks about the trade coming down for blue-green stone. So it looks like that network was still in existence there, but probably not as extensively or as strongly in, controlled. So in general, what we think we had was a couple of, if you think back, it starts off with a very general system of trade in shell. It's kind of a downline trade, with sort of corporate nexus with villages, probably the heads of the villages, maybe having a little more status, being able to acquire it. And then you get this shift with the rise of Chaco into a more structured network of trade. And Chaco probably was for the most elite and hierarchical system that we would have had. In Pacame, when that collapses, you see a hiatus and then the rise of the Pacame system. And Pacame would have been doing a lot of control and manipulating the trade networks into the southwest. When it collapses, it becomes more dispersed again. I seem to be competing with the background. I think that probably covers most.
Alrighty. So with that, I'll go ahead and open the floor to questions. Are there any questions? Okay, we'll start over here.
Mr. Vokes, is there any evidence of mercury or mercuric oxide being imported to this area?
I don't know of any evidence of importing. I'm not sure whether it would have been involved in the later copper working, but I don't know of any direct evidence of importation.
Is there any evidence or any work that you know that's been done up in the Havasupai area?
The Havasupai area, the Canyon Canyon area, there is little archaeology right in that area that's been done. North of the rim, up in the Arizona Strip area and southern Utah, there's been some work done. And we have evidence there of trade coming from both California along probably the Mojave Trail and the sort of branch that runs up into the New River or the Las Vegas area. And then also there is shell, at least, looks like it was mixed with shell coming from the south, from the Holocon region. And it looks mainly that the basket maker, which is what I'm mostly familiar with up there, the basket maker was a lot of California trade coming in. And then later, the Holocon stuff moves into the area.
You mentioned turquoise heading south as an item that would have been for trade. I know it's not exactly an exotic item, but is there evidence for cotton being imported south into the Mesoamerican region?
I don't know that there's any direct evidence, but I'm not sure how it would be show up in the record. We certainly know that they were making cotton, they were growing it and working it throughout a lot of these regions in the Southwest, but I don't know of any archaeological evidence, direct evidence of it being imported south. Yeah.
Okay. Next question.
It appears that metals were used for ornaments and personal possessions, but not tools. And I've never heard any evidence of iron working in North America.
Not of iron.
Is this correct? And is there some way to understand why that is?
Well, for one thing, I'm not sure that the copper working. Basically, you had the native copper, which they could have started working at cold, even. The idea of being able to do alloys and stuff seems to have been restricted to copper. You do get some copper tweezers and things being made, and rings and stuff, but that's as much as they got. Also, there was no real evidence for any other metallurgy, nothing of the silver or gold working being done. That was common south of there. So,
I think it was Pat Gilman who did an analysis of the images on the Mimbres pottery showing macaws,
right.
And that the overwhelming majority of the figures that could be identified as far as gender goes or sex goes were female.
There's a lot of the females are showing.
Yeah, I mean, in your example, it looks like it's one to one there.
Yeah.
But there were like two men and, you know.
Yeah, there was
15 women.
I don't know
exactly
how many images, but the women appeared to be very common in the images of members of the people that were actually caring for the birds, which led her to suggest that women may have been coming up, people may have been going down, women were either traveling down or to attain these birds, or they were being, they were coming up as brides or something and be coming in. Interestingly enough, there's been a little bit of DNA work done on some of the burials in the Mimbres area, and they have, there's connections that have shown up to the area of the Tarahumara and another group that I can't remember off the top of my head, but that are from northern central Mexico. Now, her conclusion was in the last paper was she was talking about how these women may have come up, but the question is what happened to the Mimbres when the system closed, and did they go south? I mean, it would be another way for that connection to have been established. But yeah, there's some interesting things. I don't know if you've seen her most recent paper where she was talking about the symbolism, Mesoamerican symbolism, and macaws in the Mimbres area, and they're talking about the legend of the twins. Yeah, it's an interesting paper.
We were on a trip to the Salton Sea area in California in January with Bob Scarborough along, and he claimed that the obsidian from that area had been identified all the way to Michigan. Now, you know, that's not an exotic, but it was probably being used for arrowheads.
I'm not familiar with it being that far. I mean, there's lots of obsidian outcroppings closer to it, so.
Yeah, well, he claimed that specific obsidian had been.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with that.
My recollections aren't as good as they used to be.
Happens to all of us.
When DePeso excavated Wind Mountain outside of Silver City, the Mimbrus site. They traced the turquoise at that site to a mine, turquoise mine, right above it in the mountains. Are you familiar with that site and whatever?
I'm a little familiar with Wind Mountain, and I think you're thinking of either Azul or Tyrone is the source for those, that material. Those were two very large sources that were you find throughout western New Mexico and up into the Chaco region are coming from those areas. And in the later into the Salado area of Round Globe.
So it was a major.
It was. There were some major sources in their mines.
Of sourcing that has been done of turquoise from the Valley of Mexico, what sites in the Southwest or what mines in the Southwest are represented?
Well, okay, it depends on who you talk to, for one thing.
Okay, we're talking to you.
Okay. Phil Wigan and Harbottle were probably the best known. Some people have taken some issue with some of their techniques and stuff, but they were saying that certainly Cerrillos outside of Santa Fe, the two sites that were just on the Azul, Tyrone sites, and what's the other one? There's some, I have to look at my map, but there are some in the old Hachita site, I think, is also represented in some of that. I'm not sure whether any of the Sleeping Beauty was connected into that at all, but definitely Cerrillos was. So the more recent work that's being done right now, where they're doing chemical sourcing and stuff and looking at the with the turquoise, I think has confirmed at least Cerrillos, but I don't know that the other ones have been confirmed on that.
This may or may not be the area of your expertise, but at what age do macaws talk?
That I don't know.
I think that silence in archaeology needs to be speculated about and filled. Great stories there.
If you think about it, though, if you were somebody who had had a macaw and it did talk, you would be talk about having status. So one of the things which Pat Gilman's paper that she just put out was, you know, her theory is that people were going to get these birds and bringing them back. As she said, it's a long way to get them, since we don't know any in between sources. But the status of having that specialized knowledge would have been very important in terms of your role in the community. So I think that she has it's an interesting idea that she's posted. It would explain a lot about why you get just sort of these nodes of these macaws.
Could you talk about the function of the bells and the shell trumpet, either musically or ceremonially?
Okay. Well, we'll start with the bells because I can talk a lot about trumpets. Bells. Were probably, I mean, they were musically in the sense that they tinkled. They would leave pebbles in them so that they would rattle. Their importance probably was more for what they were than so much as for the sound, but they would have been very high status kinds of things. Again, it's a non-local control of something that would have been visual. In the burial of the magician, for instance, he didn't have any copper bells, but he had in his hand a wrap of conus shells that would have been a rattle. And I suspect copper bells probably would have been something that might have been shown in that way, that they would have used very visually in their hands. This is conjecture, but that would be my thoughts on that. The trumpets were used in a couple of ways. They get used in ceremonies. They're used today by some of the Pueblo tribes. In some of the ceremonies, they're supposed to represent wind and the calls of certain spirits and things like that. The Hopi and Zuni use them. We also know that from the Spanish record
that the trumpets were used in warfare. You have descriptions both from Mesoamerica where they would, Cortez refers to the trumpets being blown as they were rallying the troops to fight. Coronado, when he was coming up, talks about hearing trumpets, these shell trumpets being blown to coordinate attacks on him. And he was coming up in through the area towards Zuni. So they have a lot of different roles in the system.
So by coordinating, do you mean messages?
Well, signals. Perhaps when to attack or things. It wouldn't have been all that variable in sound, so you couldn't have really gotten a lot of directions particularly, but certainly it would have worked in signals for attacking or retreating. And as I said, in the rituals, they're usually used for symbols of sound of wind and stuff.
Well, just one more thing. The little bells, were they used as ornaments on clothing?
We don't really know because they tend not to occur with textiles, and so they're sort of isolated occurrences. So they are sometimes found wrapped in burials with textiles, but they're not really sewn on them.
Hey, another question? All right, Arthur, thank you so very much.